God damn it.
Woo! Oh, that's running.
But they're so slick, man. It's like hogging 15 loogies into your hand and then rubbing it in butter. Oh, that was my personal best.
Yeah, baby.
I'm out perch fishing and I hook a great white.
That's the biggest line of them that I've ever heard.
What's up, guys? Nick the Informative Fisherman out here with my buddy Matt today. We're out on the American River bank fishing for American shad. American River, American shad, right? Kind of synonymous. Using my iRod crappie rod for the shad. Nice and light setup right now. We're out here in the afternoon, which is not always the prime time for shad, but we're still catching them. We're having to work for them. I'll show you a little setup I did right here, if I can land this fish. I'm not using a net today. That takes all the fun out of it. Right, Matt? No net. No net. Bring net, you catch no fish. Leave the net at home, you catch them all day long. Bigger ones than you've ever caught, too. Look at this guy. Pretty fish. Pretty fish. Try not to get that other hook in my hand. Look at that fish right there. American shad. Beauty. You can see what I've done here is I've taken three drop shots. Normally I use like a steelhead slinky, and I got two size 8 circle hooks on with these little champagne grubs, man. These things are 1-inch grubs. A circle hook got them right through the nose. And I'm basically letting it swing right along the bottom. And as it's bouncing across the bottom, these shad are just sitting down there. Whoop, he's in shock. There he goes. There he goes, right by your feet. They're sitting down there. Look, he's swimming right up to you. How about that? So what's going on is they're down there hunkering against the bottom. They're basically a low light feeder, but you can still catch them in the middle of the day. They're hugging the bottom, and these split shots are ticking the bottom, and at the same time, this little grub's just swinging through, but I'm feeling a ton of bottom contact. So I use the circle hook. That way, if the fish grabs it, I don't want to jerk and break off my weights or break off a light setup, and I got two of them right here. If they grab it, I just start reeling into it. And just like that, that little circle hook does the work. It turns, it's in the corner of the mouth, the nose, or the lower lip. And I know they're not gonna choke it, so it's nice, safe, and release. We got our barbs pinched down, so we're not harming these fish. Little tiny hooks. Let's go get some more, Matt.
Further out there.
Yeah, they're in that middle. See the middle run where it went?
Yeah.
See how messed up my bobber was too? The only way I knew it was on, that bobber started spinning. I'll let it go.
So if you look at the current right here, you can see if I cast up there, I'm going to get a bunch of slack in my line. So basically I'm going to cast kind of parallel to the current here, but a little bit up, just slightly out there, and then I'm going to hold my rod straight up. And the reason for this straight up is that line angle, you kind of want your line being in the same speed of water to where your baits land, because the water speed back here is different versus the water speed out there. So by holding your rod straight up with these little circle hooks, I can feel the bite if I need to just reel into them and set the hook. But if I have my line in the water right here, it would create bow or a lot of drag because the water speed's consistently different versus out there versus out here. So the more line angle I have pointed straight down at my baits while they're just drifting and bouncing along the bottom, the better bite detection I'm gonna have. Ultimately, if I put my line down, they're still gonna be bouncing across the bottom. It could create a lot of drag and speed them up a little bit too much to where they won't hit them, but it's much better to have your rod up and that line angle steeper so you have less line in the water. Therefore, you're gonna feel that little weight bouncing across the bottom. You're gonna have a whole lot better detection. You're gonna know when that fish grabs it, and it's gonna present those lures to your fish a lot better. So I'm just gonna make a short cast to give you guys a prime example of something here. So I cast it straight out in front of me. As my line's bouncing across the bottom, I'm gonna let my line hold tight and I'm gonna swing. So as it's creating tension, the river's gonna pull my line to the side. It's gonna find the seam, the less strong current, and it's gonna just move it right out of the way. I hooked up on a rock there. I'm just going to lift my line tight. And as you can see, my line's moving back this way. The cool part about when you're fishing for shad is they line up in a line facing upstream. So by doing this and taking a couple steps down every few casts and letting it swing through at the end, don't reel it up as soon as you think it's going to go tight at the end of your cast. Let it go all the way through, because now your lure's traveling at a horizontal plane across the water instead of straight up and down with it. Therefore, you could cross through a school of shad at that point. If it's swinging back and I get bit over there on the swing, I might want to step down and try to get my baits in that strike zone for a longer period of time. But always let it swing, let it pause for a second. As soon as it's straight back like that, before you bring it in. A lot of the time on that pause is when they're going to grab it too.
I got it. It was that light bite again.
So Matt, I know one of the real popular things to do for these shad is float fishing. Why don't you break down your setup for us here? Because that's a monstrous float.
This is a monster float. This is a custom made float that I found here on the river. There is actually a big group of people that will use these big floats. When they're bigger like this, weighted in the bottom, it'll slow the drift down.
Slow the drift down. Plus, you can bomb it way the hell out there.
Correct. You can get a far cast. I run braid on the main line, real light braid. That way, it's very sensitive. You can cast farther.
And it floats.
Correct.
And you can mend it easier. Mending means moving your line on top of the current to place it into slower water or to faster water to where your bobber doesn't have a bunch of resistance from the current against it. Kind of like I was talking about earlier. Then from your leader here?
From the leader here, I come down about 4 or 6 feet. Mono or fluoro, whatever you like. I prefer mono most of the time because of the stretch.
Shad have soft mouths. The stretch is helping.
They do. And 2 to 4 pound mono. And then we're running a 1/32nd jig head. Pinch it down, barbless up here, and a 1-inch grub. And then a couple split shots for depth or speed, depending on, you know, the speed of the water is pretty important too. It's like you want to have a walking pace, almost like steelhead fishing.
Yeah, they're going to sit in that walking pace water instead of that rip snorting current. You know, one of the things that I like to explain to people too is if you can see the river's traveling from this way to that way, if you see your float sitting like this, that means your bait's being blown out beyond it and it's up away from the bottom. So you can either add some split shot to straighten that float out. Then if you see your float doing this occasionally, it's ticking the bottom, which is a good thing. Especially when the sun's out, those shad are hunkered down to the bottom. But generally you want to be where it's occasionally every few seconds barely ticking the bottom, but you want that float completely straight in a river system, because it's going to tell you if you're not have enough weight on there and your bait's not near the bottom, or if you're ticking bottom. So getting that float to be perfectly straight up, and Matt has just the right amount of weight on there to do that, is absolutely critical when float fishing.
Bite up.
Behind the back? You were going for behind the back?
I was.
Come on.
A lot of the time you got to use that thigh pinch. That's critical to landing these fish without a net. It's all about the thigh pinch.
Yeah. It's a male.
Yeah?
Pretty little fish.
That's a big male, huh?
Yeah.
A little fatty. Got it. Whee! I was going to turn them sideways for you guys, but they're so slick, man. It's like hogging 15 loogies into your hand and then rubbing it in butter and then warming it up and putting some fresh minced garlic in there and then squeezing real hard. It's almost impossible.
Just remember to wash off for you.
But they can be tasty if prepared right. That's what I was getting to.
Correct.
Hang with us, guys. We'll be right back. Oh, you heard they got weapons of big fish destruction? Well, you heard right. BWA Fishing Performance is the newest company hitting the U.S. market by storm. With some of the sickest swim baits around and non-cookie cutter style lures that you could ever get your hands on, it's time to show these fish something new. Visit BWA.com. Hey guys, did you know that Yours Truly is now hosting Lucky Tackle Box's monthly panfish instructionals? And aside from relentless fish catching, I'll be breaking down the rigging and the gear you need to get going along the way. And of course, a few extra tips to help you score more fish on the goodies included in your box. So remember, the tug is our drug, so go visit LuckyTackleBox.com and get signed up today. Attention Northern California anglers, have you been to Boat Country in Escalon with one of the largest selections of welded aluminum fishing boats from North River, Hughescraft, and now Crestliner? Chances are they have the right boat for you. And did I mention they have a full service center to take care of all your repair or boating maintenance needs? If you're a boat owner or just looking to become one, you owe it to yourself to check these guys out. Visit BoatCountryUSA.com or stop on by. We'll see you there. Bigger, better, badder. The evolution of the buzz bait is upon us. The Evolution Bait's grass burner is a high-performance bass snatching machine. High-end components, inline displacement, larger profile, balanced body for fast or slower retrieves, better deflection, and oversized treble hooks. You wouldn't bring a slingshot to a gunfight, would you? Find out more at evolutionbaits.com. Are you into diving, surfing, or fishing? And have you checked out the Salt Life YouTube channel yet? From awesome surfing insight to scuba diving locations and in and offshore fishing, bundled up with all sorts of crazy cool footage, the Salt Life has you ocean lovers covered. So go check out their YouTube channel and tell them if sent you. Did you know that Beeline makes specialized lines for all your fishing needs? From the super strong abrasive resistant CXX or the low stretch super stealthy CX Premium, or maybe you're looking for invisibility or super bite detection with Beeline's 100% fluorocarbon. No matter what your needs, Beeline's got it covered. To find out more, visit Beeline.com.
Beeline, baby!
Ever tried pulling a planer board next to your boat when trolling or fishing from a swift current bank? If not, you're missing out on one of the most phenomenal fish catching machines on the market today. With Yellowbird planer boards pulling your lines perpendicular to your boat, you can't help but catch more fish. Find out more by visiting www.yellowbirdproducts.com.
All right, guys, we had to make a location change and come back another day. We were fishing sunrise, but the amount of tubers and swimmers and people jumping off the bridge got crazy, got way too hot, and that section blew out. We couldn't find any other fish, so we waited about a week, and we came back for more fish to move into the system. We're now right at the very beginning of July, and we're here at a section called Harrington, and float fishing this big section, trying to find that fast walking speed water. Using a big P-line slip float like that, and got the first shad of the morning here. Not bad for a nice sunny day out here on the river, wading in cold water. It's gonna be about 100 degrees. There he goes, swimming off. I was gonna release him anyways. Of course, we're squeezing down barbless. I got that 130 seconds ounce P-line. It's like a pink champagne jig head on there with that 1-inch grub. And that little hook like that, pinch down the barb. I have a 8-pound fluorocarbon leader, and I squeezed a bunch of split shot up there, and I have a chain swivel on. You know, on the river like this, you can get a lot of twists, but a little barrel swivel's fine. And I got that Poochie float right there, the bead, and the bobber stop up here. Right now, I'm set to about 4.5 foot deep, according to the river levels. Every other cast, I want to see my grub hitting the bottom, so I want to see a little bottom contact every now and then. As that sun comes up, these shad are going to push back down to the bottom. But hopefully we can give you some more tips today. Wow! Look at this little fella. Look at that little tiny shad. Let's let him go. Here you go, buddy. Another little one. Found a school of little shad. I'm just gonna slide my hand right down, do that grub, and try to pop it out of his jaws just like that. It's a bigger one. I'll hold him up in front of the camera for you, but if I don't need to take him out of the water since I'm doing catch and release, I won't. Oh no, he's a little better. Right there in that current, look at that. There you go. Not bad. Straight through the nose. I'll take it. Now, I want to talk to you guys a little bit about something that we've covered in our fly fishing episodes and probably another stream episode, but when I cast up there, the current's running down. It's imperative that when I get that strike that I set downstream. The reason for this is these fish are facing upstream. There's no reason for me to pull that plug away from the fish. If I pull downstream, I'm driving that hook point towards that fish. And even the same thing applies if you cast out there and you hook a fish and you're fighting the fish. If it gets downstream of you, the only option you have is to keep your rod high to where it's keeping that hook point up against that fish's nose. If the fish has, if he's out here and he's fighting you out here and running and that current's running down, you need to keep your rod at the angle to where it's constantly driving pressure towards that fish's mouth. So if he's downstream of you, keep a high rod position. If he's out here next to you, keep a downstream rod position as you're fighting him. You never want to pull the fish upstream. Basically, if you're pulling down and he's facing up, it's wearing the fish out faster against that current. If you're trying to pull him upstream, that's the direction he's headed anyway, so that doesn't do you any benefit unless that fish is down here, hold your rod up high. But if he's out here, anywhere in here, keep that rod pressure downstream.
Shad today. If he comes in. That's a big shad. No striper went for that.
I'm pretty sure.
That's a pretty big shad.
That is a big shad, huh?
Yeah.
Oh, that's a nice one.
That's a nice shad.
Oh, that was my personal best shad right there. That was about 3.5 pounds, baby.
Yeah.
Woo! That was a big one.
Thanks for teaching me how to catch shad.
Hey, no problem, Matt.
Like I forgot how to do that after watching you catch those 7 and brought it back.
The flashback.
Oh, this one's made it already. It's spent.
All right, guys. So when it comes to float fishing, like I was talking about earlier, if your line's tight from your rod to the float, you're going to have current resistance against your float. It's going to drag and it's going to hold tight across the surface of the water. And I was talking about mending, basically lifting your line up and down above the float or behind the float to where your float, instead of sitting like this, will come back upright. And it's basically moving your line out of the faster current. And it's easy to do with a fly rod. It's called stack mending, where you throw slack line behind your indicator to give it a drag-free presentation. But on a spinning rod, when it lands, you want some slack near your float to where your float stays upright, like that. If it lands with tension, my float's gonna land sideways. So it's as simple as this. When I'm throwing my float, I wanna finish with my rod tip up, like that. And if you see, about 3 feet of slack landed directly behind my float. Now, the opposite. If I land with my rod tip down, basically creating less of an arc, if I throw more of a line drive, out there and I hold tight, well, immediately I have tension and my float won't stand up. So it's imperative that slack lands behind it. The higher the arc you have coming in, that slack line is gonna follow your float, which is critical for a drag-free presentation.
Here's how you tell if they're a big shad. See how it takes one hand to grip it? The two-handed ones are the real big ones. So this is a one-hander. It's a female, she hasn't spawned yet. You can tell she's got some eggs in her still.
So Matt, I know shad fishing's synonymous with May, June, July, and pretty much all of our river systems, but there's a reason I'm out here with you today. When do you start fishing these things?
Embarrassingly, I start in March.
March?
March. My earliest fish was was last year during a drought, so we can't really count that. But
sure.
Right after my birthday. So in a little late in March, we were catching shad.
You're catching shad.
Correct.
So they do come in early. I know a lot of people are thinking, you know, middle of May through middle of July. And that's probably the prime time if you want to guarantee yourself some fish. But if you want to get hardcore and get on it early, before there's a lot of pressure on the rivers on the weekends. You know, we're out here during the weekday, but the weekends can get a lot of pressure out here. But if you want to get on it early, you could start as early as mid-March, you would say?
I'd say mid-March, right when steelhead are starting to
die down, I just switch right over. It's
easy to do. It's a good test if you're out steelhead fishing, right?
Yeah.
Try a couple of, bring a shad rod, try it a few times, see if you get one.
Correct.
That's your seasons, guys. 100 plus degrees. Oh, real cold river. Gotta get out here for them. Sometimes there's one of those little eddies way back out there that you just gotta cast to, and wading out an additional 6 to 8 feet off the bank can make all the difference in the world. Not a big one, but another fun shad to catch. Oh my. And he's off. Perfect.
They're holding in that backwater. Oh. You just lost one, dude. We almost had a double.
Yeah.
If you look out there, you can see below those snags, it'll slow the river down. And the fish will just sit right below that, get a little break in the current. It creates a spot where the bobber will almost just stay stationary and allow your bait to be down there longer. Come on.
Slow down.
One thing to get them to quit moving around is you turn them upside down. I don't know why, they don't like being upside down.
Just like a shark.
Is that what sharks do too?
Yeah. That's actually identical to great white sharks, Matt. From time to time when I'm out perch fishing and I hook a great white, when I bring him in to calm him down so he doesn't kill anybody, I grab him by the tail with one hand and usually just rotate him over.
Wow. That's the biggest line of bullshit I've ever heard.
Well, I missed my spot this time, so.
That's a
Except
fish,
that.
Dude.
Except for that.
Fish on.
Oh, yeah. Cold belly button. That's the key to getting more bites out here. As soon as your belly button's cold, your bite ratio just through the roof, man. Gotta dip it. Dip it. Gotta dip it. Woo! Woo! That was a good run. Shad, man. Call it the broke man's tarpon for a reason. Listen to that. Oh, that's a good one. Grab that cash with both hands, that paper
stash. Oh, so chrome, man. I could brush my teeth against the side of this thing.
Dang, these things are just horses, man. Just not backing off. And they have really paper thin mouths, so I can't horse the thing at all. So I'm sitting here just biting this thing while he's bulldogging me in the current. Oh, yeah. I'm all right, Jack.
Hook fell out right there. Yeah, baby. What a pretty shad.
Yeah, let's let her go. Bye bye. Yeah. Bobber down production. Oh, he's off. He's off. No. Alright guys, so that's it for a couple days of efforts out here on the American River. I know day one we probably could have got them if we jumped around a little bit more, but we're running low on time, but we still got some fish out there with Matt. The float rigs, definitely the most dominant thing out here, probably on the American. Bottom bouncing was working, but that slack-free drift and being able to open your bail and let it get down and cover more water definitely seems the most effective way to bank fish for these shad out here. Is that what you would be using the majority of the time, Matt?
The majority of the time, yes. Early in the run, we'll be just drifting right along that deep drop.
That deep drop. You'll do that a little bit more often.
Yeah.
Yeah, but the float fishing is probably going to catch them all the time. Get near the bottom, catch these shad in the middle of the day, pulling down in these deep holes, man. Greatly appreciate you taking us out, brother. Hopefully you guys learned some more from this. Visit informativefisherman.com. We'll see you next time. Appreciate you watching.
Yeah, I gotta do something cheesy. Hi, Mom.